Hello, and welcome to our webinar on how to write a winning nomination package. My name is Kathy Hanrahan, and I'm chair of the Women in Technology Leadership Awards Committee. This webinar is being recorded and will be posted on our website for you to watch at your convenience. Hopefully, we'll help you with this webinar to navigate the nomination process, which is pretty straightforward, but this will give you some pointers and tips to help your nomination become a winning one. Once you have a chance to view it and access the nomination form online, please feel free to contact us with any questions. I'll give you our contact information at the end of the presentation. What we'll cover today to familiarize you with women in technology, and we'll show you the timeline for the process and our award categories and criteria. Joining me today is also Allison Ferris, a winner from our awards last year, and she's going to share her perspective and advice. We'll also share a few common mistakes we've seen for you to avoid, and then end with how to contact us. First of all, for those who aren't familiar, Women in Technology is based in the DC metro area with over 1,000 members, and you see our mission on the slide here. Our various programs include things like Girls in Technology, with programs and activities for elementary through high school girls, a mentor-protege program, and another application-based program, the Leadership Foundry, that helps prepare executive women for corporate board service. In the Leadership Awards program, we're focused on recognizing DC area women devoted to continuing WIT's mission. We've honored nearly 1,000 amazing women in the last 21 years, and it's an impressive alumni group from all points in their careers, from rising stars to senior women leaders and successful entrepreneurs. We look forward to another outstanding group of nominees this year. You can either self-nominate or nominate one or more other people, and you can nominate an individual in more than one category if it's appropriate, and we'll cover those categories in just a few minutes. First of all, the timeline is very important because there is a deadline of November 11th for submitting your nomination. The nominations are currently open and we'll announce finalists around the end of January, and our Leadership Awards event where we make the presentations is May 21st of next year. We have an independent judges group from all areas of industry, government, and academia, who will then review and score the incoming nominations to determine finalists and winners. We'll announce those finalists, like I said, in late January, and they must be able to attend the awards banquet in May, which is held at the Sheraton Tysons, Virginia. And it's an inspiring event if you haven't attended, where we hear the remarkable stories of the women who've been finalists and finally winners. So let me go first through our award categories. You'll see all of this on the website where you do the nomination, and so I'll run through it quickly here. There's differences in each as well as recurring themes, so please make sure you select the right category for a candidate. And we've highlighted also in the slide last year's winners in each of these categories. We have three corporate categories, and they're based on size, which you'll see here in the criteria. For the large market sector, for example, these are for women who have exhibited traits at a business entity that's greater than 750 million. So very large business. In each category where you'll see the ideal candidate, we're really looking to honor a woman who has exceptional, well-rounded experience in her career and has succeeded on her own, has succeeded helping other women, and she's made a contribution to her field or community. In the large market sector, we recognized Toni Townes Whitley for Microsoft this year. In the mid-market sector, the big difference here from the large market is the size, as I mentioned. So annual revenue between $50 million and $750 million for the organization. And as you see here, from New Star, Padma Chitrop, who was the winner from last year. Our small market sector is for women in business entities at less than $50 million, again, serving anyone in the commercial, government, or nonprofit space. Hildy Pineda from Able Bets was our winner last year. The next category is government and defense. We had two separate categories last year, and so you'll see two separate women in these categories this year. But these are really to recognize women who are working for a federal, state, or a local government agency or entity, specifically not an organization or nonprofit that works with the government. So it has to be someone who works directly for a government organization or is currently employed or recently retired from military service. Given our DC metro area has a large concentration of government entities, we've seen some great nominees in this category in prior years. This year, this past year, Cherie Smith from the U.S. Army, PEOEIS, Enterprise Information Systems Office, won in the government category, and Darlene Straub with Defense Information Systems Agency on the defense side. In the small business and entrepreneur category, this is really to recognize someone who has shown exemplary skills and leadership traits for a small entity of less than $50 million or is an entrepreneur. Last year, Janelle Merritt from Digidoc Inc. was our winner. The STEM leadership category is a fairly broad one, but specifically focused on someone who has really contributed to the STEM field in a big, big way. And this is someone who's advanced their career, sponsored others, perhaps been involved or sponsored STEM programs for their business or community. And you may have a potential nominee who fits in this category as well as another. And it's okay to nominate someone in more than one category if it's appropriate. But one thing that you really need to remember is that if you nominate someone in more than one category, you really must complete separate nomination forms, one for each of the categories. The next category is kind of a personal favorite of mine because there are a lot of women who don't get a lot of accolades, outside recognition or awards, and they really don't seek the limelight, but they're doing some amazing things. It's a great opportunity here to recognize a woman who you feel is very deserving of recognition for her behind-the-scenes accomplishments. And this year, our winner was from Accenture, Mawish Hamlani. The next category is Rising Star. As I mentioned, we recognize women at all stages of their career, and this is really for someone in the early stage of their career journey who's shown really strong evidence of potential to go even further. They're doing amazing things, receiving accolades, starting to climb the career ladder, and really this is an opportunity to praise them for what their accomplishments are so far and what they're accomplishing in their career. This year's winner was Allison Ferris, and she's also joining us today on the webinar to tell her story a little bit later. The academia category is intended to recognize and acknowledge women in the field of higher education who've made programs, built programs, made a difference in teaching and advocating for and mentoring women students, for them to choose and excel in future technology careers. The last year's winner was Jill Klein from American University. And this category really is an opportunity to recognize someone who you may know in the field of academia that really needs to be called out, needs to be recognized. All of this information, by the way, as I mentioned, is on the website in the nomination form as you go through the application process. And feel free to download a draft form for you to complete and share for review and circulate as needed. But make sure you copy and paste everything into the online form because that's the only means of formal submittal. So let's move on to the selection criteria. Each award category is evaluated on four key dimensions: leadership, achievement, mentorship, and community engagement. And all are really important to cover in your nomination. So make sure you submit a thorough one and are also visible in the nomination form as you complete it. The important thing here is really to include discrete, measurable, and concrete examples of how the woman embodies the WIT values. And that will make the difference in how your nominee is judged and scored. And keep in mind, all criteria are scored, so please don't leave any section blank. So let's delve into those a minute. First of all, leadership. Does your nominee demonstrate the ability to create and implement a vision for her team? This woman would be a visible leader as a pioneer of change. And then you want to document specific examples of how they're doing that, what the person's done. Does she motivate employees and team members and have a really tangible track record to show it? How has she done it? What's been the result? Does she lead by example? Does she inspire employees and team members to take smart risks and to drive positive change? Can you provide specific examples of that to make it real? Judges will be scoring against these bullet points and looking for evidence backed up by those concrete statistics, facts, awards, revenue numbers, etc. So I can't stress enough that these examples are the differentiators in showing the relative merit among the nominees. Next is achievement. So these are some of the questions you should be asking yourself. Has she achieved a high level of success and competency? You want to describe that and what it means. Has she demonstrated success at implementing or promoting technology, management principles, or specific operational organizational processes? What were they? and why are they meaningful? Again, does she take smart risks to advance organizational and personal goals? Risks can have positive or negative outcomes. And both really are valuable to demonstrate what the woman has overcome and how she's dealt with them. And we encourage you to share those. So these are exactly what the things are the judges are going to be scoring against. When we talk about mentorship, how are they embodying the WIT values and mission? You go back to the mission of our organization. Mentoring is really done at all levels. So think of examples of how they're doing that. Ideally, you know, specific cases, numbers, or outcomes. And in developing future woman leaders, how is she sharing her skills? And what impact has it had? How can you show she's being a pioneer in advancing women in her organization and community? Finally, community engagement. This area really allows you to show the nominee's influence and how she takes part in activities beyond her job or organization. Many women are involved in things at work, but this category really shows women who have branched beyond that and have really extended their reach. And the judges definitely do look at this. So what activities beyond her job does she engage in that contribute to helping and improving conditions of others, both on the job and in the wider community? So what organizations does she participate in? Is she active in a professional or charitable endeavor? Those are all things you want to mention here. And how does her doing that encourage and enable a legacy of building strong female leaders? And among, you know, girls or women in the industry. So give good examples of the impact she makes. So spend a little time on this criteria, because sometimes people don't spend as much time on this one, but it's definitely a part of the scoring and weighting process. So a couple things, and this is probably not news. A lot of times women stand back and don't put themselves forward as our own worst critics. We've heard this over and over again from women at all stages of their career, and I certainly can relate to it personally. But this is not a time to do that. So you really need to really tout accomplishments and don't downplay or overlook things that you or your nominee have done. So this is really an opportunity. For example, if you have someone in mind to nominate and they might be hesitant, really encourage her and laud her accomplishments. It's amazing the stories we've heard. So a good way to do this, sometimes we tend to kind of put our accomplishments in the background and look forward, really help either yourself get unstuck or your nominee get unstuck. You know, we've all heard the expression, sometimes it takes a village. It's a good area to collaborate. Ask, you know, friends, colleagues, mentors, bosses, you know, what are the things that really make this person stand out, and try to capture them in your nomination. Now, what I'd like to do is turn the speaking role over to Allison Ferris. She is our Rising Star winner from this past year, and I think she's got a great story for you to hear. Allison?
Thank you so much, Kathy. And again, I want to just reiterate how fortunate I am to have been able to not only go through this process last year, but be able to connect and learn from the opportunities of just applying and or just really submitting a nomination. My journey really began when I received the initial WIT Award nomination email and didn't think twice to even consider myself for an award. It wasn't until I received an email from one of my close mentors at work that she wanted me to submit a nomination. And like Kathy had mentioned, I was very hesitant at first to actually do it and to respond because I felt a lot of self-doubt. I felt like I was so early in my career that I didn't have that much to offer or hadn't had achieved as much as I really wanted to in my early stages of my career. Of course, I was afraid to fail, really, how putting myself out there was really a hard thing for me to do, to be able to be vulnerable and kind of share my story of my personal and professional career. And then again, the tendency to downplay my accomplishments that others found remarkable was something that, of course, I always had the tendency to do. And especially because of my background, being someone who kind of had a non-traditional route into the world of technology, being a musician and then transitioning into the world of technology, a part of me was something that was actually a part of me that I held back early in my career and something that, again, was really hard for me to talk about when I first joined Microsoft as a college hire. So talking about the benefits of putting together my nomination, and this was something that ultimately drove my decision to just do it and to go for it, regardless of the outcome. And so for me, I really gained so much value in just putting together a nomination itself, to have the opportunity to work with my mentor in putting together a nomination and gain an outside perspective from other people. That was something that I felt was extremely valuable to actually do. And it allowed me to, it kind of forced myself to word dump everything that I had done early in my career and kind of take a step back and reevaluating the goals that I had set for myself when I first joined the company and was looking towards building out what goals I wanted to achieve within my 5-10 year plan of being a young professional. It forced me to gain invaluable experience advocating for myself, which is so much easier said than done. I know that I can speak to so many women when it comes down to the time where you have to advocate for yourself or to really talk about the experiences and the work that you've accomplished with, whether it be your team members or your manager or just putting together a resume. It's so much harder than it sounds when it comes down to it. And so it was a great tool to allow me to just continue to practice advocating for myself and feeling confident in my capabilities and allow me to also understand that just because I'm not a subject matter expert doesn't mean that I don't still bring value to a particular area or field of in my team and in my job. Gaining feedback, that is something I've always been a big advocate for, just making sure that I'm always understanding where I can do better and be better and grow, especially since I am very early in my career. And it also allowed me to kind of take this exercise and apply it to preparing me and really positioning me for a new opportunity abroad, which was something that I had always wanted to achieve in my career. And so the fact that I was able to go for a job that I otherwise wouldn't have was something that I really gained from putting together a nomination. And here I am sitting in London talking to you guys in a new role that I never imagined myself being able to do this early in my career. Going back to feedback, so the feedback that helped me build out a quality nomination that hopefully will help you build out a nomination for either yourself or for someone else. And something that really helped me was working closely with my mentor to gain feedback from during this process. And the top three things that come to mind when I look back during this process was picking the most appropriate category. At first, you can feel a bit overwhelmed because in my particular example, I remember thinking, oh, well, you know, I fall into a couple of different buckets, but I don't feel like I necessarily would qualify for one over the other. And so gaining her feedback and thinking that Rising Star was the most appropriate category was something that I think really helped to allow me to become successful in being a finalist and ultimately going on to winning the award itself. Directly answering the question, so this was a big feedback, a big part of the feedback that I gained from my mentor, because I would kind of forget to directly answer the original question. And building back to Kathy's points earlier, I think that's something extremely important in terms of building out a quality nomination. And to support the original question, giving specific and quantifiable information. This took me a couple rounds to do. It wasn't as easy measuring as much as I initially thought, because again, I would always try to downplay something, or I felt like something wasn't necessarily worth highlighting, but my mentor was like, no, that's something that you really definitely should highlight, because you don't realize the impact until you know, maybe an outsider tells you that. So that was something that really helped me to kind of iterate on this nomination packet and kind of hone in on making sure that I'm A, answering the question, and giving enough specific and quantifiable information. And why I'm so excited and glad that I ended up doing it. It was a great decision because it really opened up and broadened my network, even abroad. So from submitting the nomination to connecting with the Women in Tech DC Metro women and attending the awards gala allowed me to connect with women and actually make connections abroad here in London. So I've been able to connect with some women who are involved in other Women in Tech outreach programs that I wouldn't have otherwise even known about if it weren't for the incredible network that I gained from even just going through this process. Again, recognizing women in all stages of their career. As someone who's starting off in their career, it can be very overwhelming and discouraging, because you think that you think that you haven't really accomplished much, but I love the fact that you're able to connect with other Rising Star finalists and nominees, but also really be inspired by women later in their careers who are doing incredible things for not just, you know, women their age, but for women who are also early starting off in their career. I left feeling very, very inspired from all of the other women in this field, from all ages and from all backgrounds, just being able to be vulnerable and share their stories with everyone. And again, the opportunity just to pay it forward, that was something that has really driven me in my career and in tech, and the opportunity to just share with you my story and how I went from not being able to advocate for myself to being a little bit more comfortable talking about the experiences that I bring to the table and bring to the field of technology was something that I'm extremely grateful for. And thank you for allowing me to do.
Thank you, Allison. Really appreciate hearing your story, and I think you made some great points that hopefully others will take to heart. Next, let's talk about just a couple more things to make sure you know. So even if a woman works for a company who has an office here in the DC metro area, which, as I'm sure you are aware, many do, if the woman does not live and work here, she would not be eligible. This really applies to the local area women in the broader DC metro area. The event is held, as I mentioned earlier, on May 21st, 2020, at the Sheraton Tysons in Tysons, Virginia. The nominee really must be available to attend the awards banquet, which is really part of the recognition process. On the WIT website where you found this webinar, you should have seen the URL link for the nomination tool. We'll continue to send out reminders as well during the full nomination period. Again, you or the nominee don't need to be a member of WIT, but each nomination must have a fully complete online form. You'll create a username and password to access the form and get it started. And you can use your name and password to come in and out of the online form. So save things as you go, for example. Just for those WIT members, it's not a single sign-on with WIT username and password if you have one. You will need to set a new one up for the tool. It's really a good idea, as I mentioned before, that as you're gathering your evidence, it's really useful to download the online form, which is an offline Word document, and then circulate it and use it for feedback and advice, similar to what Allison did, to really finalize the best nomination you can. Then when you're ready, you can easily copy the information into the online form. So as I mentioned, the offline Word document is not final. You can't just submit the Word document. You have to complete the online nomination tool, which is pretty easy using cut and paste. So one other thing that's kind of critical is it's not an unlimited field. It's, I think, pretty good size for you to be able to tell your story. But this is a screenshot of what you'll be seeing on the form. As I mentioned, it has the criteria and has a place for you to respond with a character counter. And that way you know where you are. One thing that's really good to keep in mind is really be concise. There's not a lot of value to the judges to run on and on without supportable statements or really concise explanation of how your nominee demonstrates this exact criteria. As I mentioned, you can save your answers at any point in the online form and go back into the system at a later date. But be sure to submit before on November 11th. Once you hit OK to submit, you cannot make further changes. So you'll see this little warning, and you really need to make sure that if you're not finished, you say save, and when you are finished, you hit that OK button. If you click the submit button there before you're finished, you'll need to contact us at the WIT office to help you, and I'll tell you their contact information at the end of the briefing. So then, really final tips. I'm sure you've heard it from both me and Allison a million times already in this webinar, but specific information really is key for someone understanding how the person's achievements have really impacted the organization, another person's career, or the mission goals. And keep in mind that we've seen some nominations talk about what the team did or the team accomplished. And we all know that teamwork really makes for a successful career, but here we're really looking for what the individual has done. Even if it's part of a team effort, what has that person done that stands out and really shows the values that we're trying to recognize here? Common mistakes. There are things that we've seen and wanted to kind of reiterate here. In some cases, nominations were very good, but in the wrong category. So really pay close attention to this. Sometimes it's obvious and we can help move a worthy candidate to another category that's more appropriate, but not always. So really give it some good thought and understand the various categories well and use the right one. And because the scoring the judges do is really numerical and it's by those four criteria, we really want to make sure that you don't miss a section, that each section will be weighted. So please, you know, put whatever you can in that section to support your nominee, and obviously be as concise as possible. So next steps are up to you. Submit your nomination by November 11th. And really appreciate your listening to this webinar. And if you have any further questions, we hope you found this information helpful. But as you get into the process, if you have a question, you can submit it either to the email address or call the contact number that you see on your screen. Thanks, everyone, and we really look forward to seeing your nominations. Good luck.